and gentlemen, I'm talking to you out of my car. I'm from Ostend on my way to Charleroi. Well, it's my pleasure to welcome you all to this webinar on unmanned and autonomous shipping. And more than 200 people from all over the world have registered to take part in this event. So good morning, good evening, or good afternoon, wherever in the world you are. For as long as we can remember, humans have built ships to conquer the seven seas. But who would have thought that ships might one day conquer those seas without us? That day, my friends, may not be that far away. We are at the dawn of a new and exciting age in the shipping industry. And I'm proud of the pioneering role that my country, Belgium, is playing in this revolution. Belgian companies are investing heavily in research and development of new technologies. They have made possible the first trial of autonomous and unmanned vehicles in our sea, that is the North Sea. Our maritime administration is working closely together with research institutes and other partners in exchanging information and expertise. Our Belgian ship owners are closely involved every step of the way, as they will be the primary future beneficiaries of this exciting new technology. As Minister of the North Sea, I took it upon myself to wholeheartedly support these initiatives and to provide the necessary legal framework to allow unmanned and autonomous vehicles in the Belgian North Sea. You will shortly be given an overview of the steps that we've taken and the new technologies Belgian companies are developing. But let me say this, our work is far from finished. Autonomous ships will only fully come to term when the necessary legal framework is put in place at the international level. Belgium is a proud member of the IMO Council. And for us, it is abundantly clear that this global framework should be put in place by the IMO. It is an indispensable precondition to ensure a level playing field and speed up the process of innovation even more. It is therefore my firm intention to use the knowledge and experience we are gaining today in Belgium in the development of that international framework within the IMO. This framework will not only contribute to the safety of shipping or the protection of the marine environment, it will also significantly improve the working conditions of seamen and seawomen. Autonomous vessels create enormous opportunities, also for the growing number of women in the shipping sector. Seamanship or seawomanship will have to be executed from ashore. This will require new qualification. And Belgium is already carrying out the necessary study work in this regard, and we will submit the results to the IMO. In short, a lot has already been done, and even more work is in the pipeline. To reach these ambitious goals, it is vital that we work together, both on the national and international level, between public and private partners, between policymakers, politicians, and industry experts. We are all on the same boat, heading for the same harbor. Belgium has always played an important role within the international context. And we, as a maritime nation, we want to continue this role within the IMO Council in the years to come. I look forward to taking further steps with you in this new and exciting era of unmanned and autonomous vessels. I wish you all an engaging and informative webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister, for your words of welcome. And indeed, we are proud to be part of this new evolution. And thank you for stressing also the role that we, all of us as states delegations, can play on the multilateral scene. Our next speaker is Aline Doufis. Aline is a legal advisor at the Directorate General for Shipping as part of the Belgian Federal Public Service of Mobility and Transport. She will take us through the legal initiatives by the Belgian flag state to support the development of autonomous shipping and gain valuable experience in support of the IMO developments on this matter. But before this, Let's take a moment to respond to the first poll question. Not the same level of excitement as autonomous vehicles in terms of developments, but still a little tech feed that will allow you to give your valuable insights. Over to you, Aline.
Thank you, Sophie. Yes, I will give more indications on the new legal framework that Belgium has developed for unmanned vessels. So to give you a quick overview, I will give a bit of context and then I will focus on three features of the framework. So DG Shipping of the Federal Public Service Mobility and Transport has noticed an increasing interest by the sector to develop projects related to unmanned vessels. These projects are very diverse and at the moment, not one resembles the other. So DG Shipping has developed this legal framework with two goals in mind, certainty and flexibility. Certainty because the sector needs to have a strong basis to build these projects, and flexibility because at this moment, as the minister said, there is no international legal framework dedicated to unmanned vessels. Currently, the IMO and its Maritime Safety Committee has completed a regulatory scoping exercise. That is an exercise that through which IMO and its member states analyze an extensive number of international conventions and investigate whether and how they could apply to unmanned vessels. And in this absence of an international legal framework and as to not prejudge IMO decisions, Belgium has decided to remain flexible. Now, the framework in itself, at a glance, it's a royal decree dated 16th June 2021, so it's very recent. It applies to all unmanned vessels sailing in Belgian maritime zones. This is the exclusive economic zone and the territorial waters of Belgium. It is due to come into force on 5th July 2021. So I will focus on three features of the framework, mainly the definition, the new procedure for licensing, and the registration of the unmanned vessels. And as a final word, I will also say what this framework is not. So as to start, currently there is no definition of unmanned vessels at the international level, as I said, and there are a number of different terms to designate what an unmanned vessel is. There's autonomous ship, there's uncrewed vessel. We have decided to go for unmanned vessel because it captures best the intention of the legislator. And so we have defined it in the first article of the framework. As a seagoing vessel that can, for all or part of its voyage, navigate without human intervention or navigate under remote control. For the purposes of this decree, remote control centers are considered an integral part of the unmanned vessel. So as you can see, there are two parts in this definition. The first sentence and the first sentence and a second sentence. In the first sentence, you can see that there are two things required for a vessel to be unmanned. It has to be a seagoing vessel, and its control mode has to allow it to derogate from existing rules of keeping watch by humans. So the control mode, so keeping watch is still obligatory, but its control mode allows it to do it without a crew member. And that's all that's required really in this definition, because we wanted it to remain flexible. So, for example, what is not required is whether the vessel sails above or under the surface, what type of control mode it has. It can be remote controlled. It can be through artificial intelligence. And whether or not there are humans on board, passengers or a crew as backup. For example, the case of the periodically unmanned bridge is included in this definition. And so the last sentence of the definition, of course, is the remote control centers, and these are included for checks by port states and flag states. Now, the second feature I want to go into more details about is the procedure for a license. So this framework requires all unmanned vessels, regardless of flag, to have a license to sail in Belgian maritime zones. We have designed a straightforward procedure. So the person responsible for a project will submit an application file to DG Shipping of the Federal Public Service Mobility and Transport. And DG Shipping will analyze the risk assessment and on a case-by-case basis, of course. And as a second step, the minister delivers a license with different conditions relating to the security of navigation, the protection of the marine environment, and others. And this license always has a fixed duration. And as I said, and I repeat it, this license is obligatory for all unmanned vessels, regardless of flag, in Belgian waters. Finally, the last feature I want to go into more detail is the registration. This is an important point for many stakeholders in the unmanned vessel business. So the Belgian Ship Registry has a general register for seagoing vessels, and this framework creates a special register for unmanned vessels. In order to be registered in this special register, the vessel has to have that license delivered by the minister, a declaration of ownership, a certificate of insurance, and also other documents on a case-by-case basis. Important features of this registry is that it's entirely free to register your unmanned vessel, and that also that foreign flagged ships can be registered in it. It's important to say that registration is possible. The unmanned vessel can also be registered in another country, but in any case, it's possible in this new register for any ship, as long as it's unmanned, of course. And as a final word, this framework does not establish a new rule on liability in case of damage and collision for unmanned ships. And of course, existing international conventions applying to traditional ships also apply to unmanned vessels, and waivers are granted on a case-by-case basis. Thank you for your attention. DG Shipping, a Federal Public Service Mobility and Transport in Belgium, remains available for any question you may have. Thank you. Back to you, Sophie.
Thank you, Aline, for taking us on this deep dive to the Belgian legal initiatives. Next up is Mark Neutemans. Mark is the CEO of our Blue Cluster, a framework to provide optimal support to members and partners and to achieve sustainable blue growth in Belgium. Mark is a master mariner with a long and diverse career in shipping. Mark will take you on the journey through the next part of this webinar. Technology providers and ship owners as operational customers will guide you through their vision of autonomous shipping, and we will square off in a Q&A session. Mark, be my guest.
Thank you very much, Sophie, and good day indeed to all of you. So the Blue Cluster is here as the Sustainable Blue Economy Innovation Hub, and we help companies lower their risk for their innovations by providing knowledge, market insights, subsidies, and of course, by weighing on decision making. We are a 200 strong assembly of private companies and also of knowledge institutes. And today I'm very proud that we have four exciting and innovative projects for you. And without further ado, I would like to introduce you to Koen Gernaert, Managing Director and co-founder of DotOcean, a maritime automation company. Very innovative. They've been working on innovation projects in the maritime industry for ports, for waterways, for wind farms, for defense, for more than a decade. And furthermore, Koen is also chairman of the Small to Medium Enterprises Committee within the Blue Cluster. Koen, the floor is yours.
I think Koen should unmute himself if possible.
Good afternoon. Thanks for the introduction, Mark. And sorry for the interruption. DotOcean is a maritime automation company. We offer technology to realize autonomous vessels. And our offering consists out of two product lines. On the one side, we offer controllers that can be mounted on any type of vessel. They are smart autopilots that allow vessels to navigate on their own. And on the other side, we connect vessels in a network. And we are offering data services to feed the controller with information. This feed contains, for instance, situational awareness information, navigation conditions, and weather conditions. This information is used by the autonomous controller to take path planning decisions. So this is a cloud service that we are offering, where, for instance, collected situational awareness derived from radar systems or camera systems or AIS is fused and fed to the vessel. We have been active for more than 10 years in automation projects for ports, waterway authorities, wind farm owners, maritime contractors, and defense. We started deployment of autonomous systems in the port of Antwerp, where an autonomous vessel is deployed for hydrographic survey applications. They are deployed in complex environments like a busy dock, and they are capable of avoiding objects in that busy dock. The unique approach is that we connect the vessel to the network with the port geographical information system and the port vessel traffic management system. So we use that information to provide that information to the vessel, and that allows autonomous control and object avoidance. So the vessel can anticipate and avoid other vessels in the port. In the next phase, we increased navigation and controllability complexity. On the River Scheldt, we deployed an autonomous vessel for DEME and the Flemish Waterway Authority. And the vessel is collecting waste and transporting waste between two docking stations, one in the middle of the river and one on the side. The situational awareness on the river is realized by a distributed radar system. There are two radar systems on the side and one on the vessel. And based on that information, the vessel is taking all other traffic in the shipping lane into account, anticipate that traffic, or avoid that traffic. In the next step, we are currently working on navigation at sea, where even more stringent and severe weather and environmental conditions can occur. DotOcean is currently investigating together with the Royal Military Academy, the Royal Higher Institute for Defense, and the Belgian Navy, how multiple autonomous vessels can work together to patrol at sea and to enable automated coastal surveillance. In this project, vessels are in combination with onshore sensors, enabling a full detection system. So the onshore sensors can detect an anomaly at sea, so an unauthorized behavior, for instance, and the unmanned vessel can go to that position and inspect that unauthorized vessel. The challenges we are currently seeing for autonomous vessels are related to two fields. There is a need to have a clear framework and a rule set for implementing object avoidance and collision avoidance. And secondly, there is a need for a communication standard that enables data sharing between unmanned vessels, but also data sharing between manned and unmanned vessels. And we hope that the IMO can take an important role in the realization of this rule set and this communication standard. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Koen. Insightful as always. And I would like now to introduce to you Steven Luys. Steven Luys is the driving force behind EK Robotics Belgium. And with the new factory here in Ostend under construction, they focus on a new generation of drones. Steven, the word floor is yours.
Good afternoon, and thank you for giving us the opportunity to present what we are contributing to autonomous shipping. Well, in fact, what I would like to explain you is the solution that the Belgian Navy, together with our consortium, have worked out the last couple of years, and that we are currently working on for turning a, I would say, a very labor-intensive, less efficient, and maybe also a little bit less safe way of demining out in the open sea into a more safe, more efficient, and faster way of demining by means of autonomous and semi-autonomous drones to be used in such demining operations. So my name is Steven Luys. I'm heading EK Group here in Belgium. EK Group is a primarily French company selling throughout the world, and we are a world specialist in drones and robots, if not or is autonomous. We have invested into three offices here in Belgium. We have a sales and marketing office in Brussels, a research center in Moucron in the west of Belgium, and as Mr. Neutermans already said, we are currently building a 5,000 square meter factory in Ostend at the Belgian Sea, where we will make the drones that I will be discussing. Why there? Because there we can test our autonomous drones directly into the port and into the North Sea, which is necessary for our operation. Why are we doing that? Because in consortium with Naval Group, a large French shipbuilding company, and that consortium is named Belgian Naval and Robotics, we have won a large contract for the Belgian Navy, in fact, for the Belgian and Dutch Navy, for the building and equipping of 12 Navy vessels for their new demining operation. And the reason why I'm presenting this to you is that I want to focus on what is happening, what are autonomous drones and robots capable of in turning a classic demining operation into a more modern, faster, safer, and more efficient operation. So let me explain you what we are doing. And this concept has been worked out by the Belgian Navy in the last couple of years. When currently navies are going to demine into a mine-infested area and into a minefield, they are navigating with a amagnetic ship into such expected minefield. And with their sonar on board of that ship, they are going to locate potential mines, potential targets. Once potential targets have been found, either a set of divers or a autonomous or non-autonomous, a ROV is being set out to identify the potential mine and to apply a charge to that mine in order for this mine to be removed from the area. You understand that this is a reasonably dangerous way of demining, but they are doing it with a very good track record. But I will explain you now how autonomous drones and systems can help making such operation faster, cheaper, and safer. So what we are doing here is you see a new type of ship presented on that slide. And that ship will let on the side of the ship autonomous drones, unmanned surface vessels, USVs named, into the water, which navigate autonomously to the minefield. The mothership that you see here in the center of that picture is remaining outside the minefield, and all the Marines on board are remaining outside the minefield. It's only the autonomous ship that goes into the minefield, and so no human life is brought in danger. It will set out a drone, an underwater drone, to go with their sonar to detect mines. If mines are detected, this information is shared with the mothership, and there they decide to use a identifying drone to go and identify the mine. Once the mine is identified, a third drone can be set into the water, which will destroy the mine and itself. This all happens in parallel with other operations, hence it's going faster, and it happens without bringing the life of the Marines into danger. There is a UAV, which is a flying drone, also involved, which can take care of over the horizon communication, and it can also take care of finding mines which are floating on the surface or are in the surf. So this whole concept is currently being designed. We are planning to deliver it in the coming years to the Belgian and Dutch Navy. And all of these drones will actually be assembled in our new factory in Ostend, making Ostend and Belgium the center for this type of applications worldwide. And it makes the Belgian and the Dutch Navy on the foreground of using autonomous drones to demine and to make this world a little bit a safer place. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Steven, for a very interesting and thought-provoking presentation on the possibilities, especially for defense, what drones can mean and what automation and autonomous ships mean in that field. Meanwhile, ladies and gentlemen, we are launching the third poll. So you have voted successfully and in large numbers for the two previous ones. So please keep up the good work. We'll start and introduce Mitch de Geest. And ladies and gentlemen, if someone owes our deepest respect, then it is for Mitch, who is a very successful serial business creator with several startups already and board members. He's a board member in several innovative companies. And today he's here to talk about his projects with CityMesh. CityMesh is a Belgian telecom operator in Wi-Fi, 4G, and 5G technology. And I'm sure he will enlighten us with some very interesting thoughts. Mitch, it's all yours.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. As Mark explained, I'm the CEO of a company called CityMesh. CityMesh is positioning itself as the fourth Belgian operator. But we have a clear focus on the applications that are being used in the context of the fourth industrial revolution. So we do not build any B2C or consumer connectivity networks, but we work together with a lot of companies who are planning to do innovative solutions and bring innovative solutions into the market. So we heard it several times during the earlier presentations that remote control and remote access to autonomous vessels will in the next coming decades still be very, very important. So that's why we as a company, we as a telecom operator, we focus on what we call deploying mobile private networks. So we have a license in Belgium, not only Belgium, but also for the North Sea to deploy 4G and 5G networks. And we do that on an on location based. So we do not supply a nationwide coverage, but we build mobile private networks in certain areas. Some examples are in ports, airports, campus, logistic centers, even city centers, and so on. And why do we do that? Is because we see an evolution all over the world that it's not from my, I didn't had a chance to see that in the past, but in the past there was something called like the public branch exchange where a lot of people, telephone people, were sitting down and dispatching a lot of information, a lot of calls between companies all over the world. But then in the 1970s, we saw that there was a company that created what we call a PBX, and that was a local telephone central that all companies put into their company. And we see the same happening on the 4G, 5G scene, where normally there are only public 4G, 5G networks that everybody uses. But a lot of companies and a lot of regions are now, even cities, are now considering deploying their own private network. And the reason those companies are thinking about deploying their own private network is because a private network guarantees you the highest mobile broadband and also the lowest latency. But even more importantly, you're totally independent of the public infrastructure. And when we're talking about remote control of flying, walking, or sailing drones, it's crucial that you have a very mission-critical, business-critical connectivity towards those vessels, in autonomous vessels, or towards those drones. Also, the cost structure of a private network is much more easy to budget, because we are working with a fixed cost as a service instead of a consumption model, depending on the areas where the vessel sails. And as I explained earlier, keeping your data local and better security and full slicing of the network becomes available when you have your own mobile private network. We've deployed a mobile private network, for example, at Brussels Airport, the international airport here in Belgium, where we have defined more than 100 use cases where all stakeholders in the airport are using the mobile private network for all their communications, IoT, but also push-to-talk, push-to-video, and remote control. We actually flew with a drone a couple of weeks ago on Brussels Airport, and the drone was remotely controlled by an operator more than 100 kilometers away in our remote operation center. So we are already doing that with flying drones at an airport. But on the other hand, the network really allows Brussels Airport to become much more resilient towards any kind of events that happen outside of the control of the airport. For example, in 2016, unfortunately, we had a terroristic attack at Brussels Airport, and they were using the public network. The public network went down because of overconsumption of that network. And now with the private network, they still have full control on what happens at the airport, even if something happens outside of the airport. To come a little bit closer to the maritime world, we also deployed a large mobile private network at the port of Zeebrugge, where we are also deploying different use cases on top of that network. But important for this webinar, we also have a full private 5G ready network in the North Sea. Most of the North Sea, that network is being used by a lot of companies that are involved with the construction and the maintenance of all our offshore wind farms that we have here in the Belgian North Sea. But we also have coverage, as I said, in the port of Zeebrugge, port of Ostende, and all major parts of Belgium and also the southern Dutch North Sea, where we have 4G and 5G access towards all our customers. And we also deployed the base station at the Westerschelde, so we can make a link between the port of Zeebrugge and the port of Antwerp, where, for example, we are working together with several companies that are doing remote control barges between Zeebrugge to the port of Antwerp. So it's very important that network is available, because we see the role of Citymesh, of ourselves, is to support all those innovative use cases that we see also with autonomous vessels and remote control vessels. It is crucial that a business critical, mission critical network is in place to support all those different innovative use cases, as I mentioned. And to wrap up, we are also quite involved with new flexible telecom tower solutions for offshore, because of course we need to have our telecom towers installed in the sea, where we can use a substation on in a wind farm. But if there's no substation, we are now working out different plans with suction buckets that can be used up to water depths of 30 meters and be quickly installed on the sea floor. But when we continue in the future towards deep sea or ultra deep water, we are also involved in a project where we are working together to construct a floating telecom tower that can be used in ultra deep water scenarios, so that even when we go each time a little bit further from shore, we can ensure mission critical connectivity towards all our customers in that vicinities. Thank you very much.
Yeah, now you all understand why Mitch is such a successful man. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mark.
Very thought-provoking. And I will have some very interesting things to say about this when we wrap up the session. And ladies and gentlemen, let me remind you, if you have questions for the speakers, please put them in the chat so that we can answer them during the Q&A. And I think everyone has voted for the three polls. Thank you very much. And then without much further ado, I would like to introduce our youngest speaker and the last, but certainly not the least, that is Louis-Robert Kool. He is the founder and CEO of CIFAR, and CIFAR is a frontrunner in semi-autonomous shipping, with already several inland waterway and even an estuarian vessel actively on the water. Louis, it's all yours.
Thank you, Mark. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Louis. I'm a CEO and founder of the company CIFAR. In this presentation, I will provide a short introduction on remote ship management and crew-reduced navigation in Belgium. CIFAR offers the service to operate vessels from a shore control center to increase efficiency by reducing onboard crew, enhance competitiveness of the vessel, and expanding the navigation hours of the ship. We focus on inland and short sea shipping to cover the main problem of crew shortage and operational costs. The crew shortage is a limitation of the growth of our sector, while the increasing costs are limiting the competitiveness of the vessel. And both need to be addressed to accelerate towards zero emission shipping. CIFAR developed and integrates a control system to automate the vessel, a sensor architecture for situational awareness, and a highly redundant communication system. Via that communication system, the vessel is connected to the shore control center, where a captain operator has the possibility to remotely steer the vessel or supervise a vessel in semi-autonomous mode. Together with the onboard technical staff, they run the vessel in a highly efficient way. The operator in the shore control center has a shift of 8 hours, making the job attractive to the new generation of captains. CIFAR develops and integrates autonomy, artificial intelligence, to increase the safety of operations. The combination of vessel autonomy and remote pilotage is the key for efficient and smart shipping. The support of a remote control center results in three operating modes. First, unmanned navigation on short and fixed trajectories. Secondly, expanding operational hours of small onboard crews. And thirdly, 24 hours operations with limited onboard crew. CIFAR offers services on retrofit and new build vessels. The experience on remote navigation is shared with vessel owners to accelerate the new build and greenification of the fleet by optimization of the CAPEX and OPEX, hybrid solutions, extended cargo capacity, and enhanced safety. Today, CIFAR operates 10 vessels on the Flemish waterways and coastal waters, ranging from 38 up to 110 meters. All vessels navigate by the shore control center under permit of local authorities, making the legislator in our industry the true accelerator for smart shipping. In this case, we are really looking forward to cooperate towards an international framework. Our tagline, the best helmsmen stand on shore. CIFAR is making this tagline the new reality. For more information or cooperation, please contact us. Thank you.
Oops. Thank you very much, Louis. And then we had at least some very interesting thoughts on how it works in real life, because you have already the experience of several ships in the water. And just, ladies and gentlemen, for the sake of argument, and before we listen to the Royal Belgian Shipowners Association, Let me just wrap up a few of the thoughts. So when we heard Koen Gernert from DotOcean speaking, there was absolutely, he stressed that there was a need for a common protocol for data, where autonomous ships can exchange data amongst themselves, but also a common protocol where autonomous ships can exchange data with non-autonomous ships, which is, I think, absolutely one of the key points and one of the key points of discussions in the decade to come when we talk about autonomous shipping. And Stephen, of course, stressed, and that is a very interesting point, the huge opportunities. And he, of course, he is mainly working in the defense industry, but that autonomous shipping, the extent that operations where human lives might be endangered can be solved by using autonomous ships. And that is, I think, one of the key points also where we have to think. There are several jobs, as you know, I am a master mariner, I've been at sea for 15 years. There are many situations where human beings have at sea to intervene in dangerous sea situations. I mean, that is absolutely a valid point that was made by Stephen. And then, of course, when I listen to Mitch, you can only listen to a little bit in awe, because it are things that generally most of us never think about, but the need for these mobile private networks and the advantages that they bring. So because they are independent of public infrastructure, they are cost efficient, and your data is local and thus much more secure. And that is one of the things, we'll see it when we get the results of the poll. Cybersecurity is, of course, a threat to anything that has to do with autonomous shipping. And then, of course, CIFAR is a real life example. And the argument that a top educated crew doesn't, there has been a shortage in the shipping industry for more than 30 years already. When you read every BIMCO report, every 5 years, the BIMCO ISF report on manning, it says there's a lack of well-educated and highly educated officers, and that you can alleviate this by semi-autonomous shipping, not remove it, just alleviate it. It lowers OPEX and increases competitivity, and it makes for lower emissions. And it's a point that is often forgotten in autonomous shipping. But then, of course, it will still require a lot of extremely well-educated officers to man these shore bases. And of course, we're here for that today, thanks to the efforts that the Federal Government Service Mobility has done and the Minister of the North Sea, the need for a regulatory framework. Fine, I will now leave you for a while in the very, very capable hands of Sophie, who will introduce Wilfried Lemmers from the Shipowners Association.
Thank you. Thank you, Mark, and especially for that wrap up and these thought-provoking insights you just shared with us, as well as the speakers. The next part of our webinar will put the ship owners in the spotlight. What are their expectations? What are their impressions? For this, I will hand over to Mr. Wilfried Lemmens, who sailed the ocean for 18 years, 10 of which as a captain on board of different types of vessels, and who is now the captain, or rather the managing director of the Royal Belgian Ship Owners Association. Wilfried.
Thank you very much, Sophie. For the Royal Belgian Ship Owners Association, it's really an honor and a pleasure to participate at this webinar. For us, the most important is that there is a good and excellent cooperation between the governments, international, within the IMO, and the maritime industry. Some of our most known members are Euronav, CMB, Compagnie Maritime Belge, Exmar, DME, and another aspect for the Belgian Ship Owners Association is that we are very concerned about emissions. Therefore, we started MIDC, Maritime Industry Decarbonization Council, in 2016. It's a think tank where on a regular basis, 2-3 times a year, we meet with the other maritime stakeholders, shipbuilders, refineries, classification societies, in order to exchange projects concerning the control or the reduction of emissions. So today I will introduce you to Wouter Eekmans, who will highlight the project of DEME. Later on, Catherine Scheers will talk about the concerns of short sea shipping owners. And then I will close the meeting about how, as deep sea owners, deep sea ship operators, we will see remote control vessels. So, Wouter, I have the pleasure to leave the floor to you.
Thank you, Wilfried. I hope I can make the link between the nice technology we just saw and what we as ship owners hope to do with it in the future. So in the next few minutes, I'll try to give you a brief view on what DEME's perspective on autonomous operations actually is. So to understand our needs, it's important to know that we as DEME are a globally active marine contractor, amongst others in dredging and offshore energy. We typically work in situations where workability is a big issue, and for that we run a really specialized fleet. We strive to make our operations more effective by getting in the correct level of automation on our vessels, and by doing so, we believe we will evolve to more autonomous operations in the future. Now, what are our main drivers to do that? The big one, crew availability, having these specialized profiles readily available, is a very big challenge. On the picture, you can see the vessel Bonnie River and the crew required to operate it. The next one, of course, is safety. We have a big campaign now in getting our people out of the so-called line of fire. Not having them there is, of course, a very effective way of achieving that. And then finally, also sustainability, like you mentioned, Wilfried. We try to make our fleet green, and we believe there is a strong link in time and technology between that and autonomous operations. Now, how do we see that happen? We don't have a glass ball, so it's hard to tell, but we believe in a stepwise approach which is aligned with our operations. So for starters, we could start sailing on safe manning by reducing the load on our people and giving them their required information. Then following that, we will try to evolve to working, for instance, dredging or wind turbine installation, with safe manning by more automation and by better knowledge of our equipment. Then further on, hopefully go more remote and move to a more decision-based approach and less to an action-based approach. And in the end, hopefully autonomous operations. By the way, you can see a timeline there in the bottom. I cannot give any guarantees on that one, of course, but I'm quite convinced that there are plenty of people here in this webinar that we will need to achieve this, both on technical as and regulatory base. Now, maybe the most exciting, what have we been doing? The Themse Brug project, already introduced by Koen from Dot Ocean a bit. We are catching plastic on the River Scheldt. And one of the things we did there is try to incorporate as much technologies, which we also see on the autonomous roadmap, as we could. One of these is this one. It's the Marine Litter Hunter. It's a fully autonomous vessel, not only in sailing, but also in mooring. But also on the crane, we do not require an operator locally anymore. So we shifted the operator to the office. We handed him his regular controls, and we virtually put him on the unloader pontoon by giving him virtual reality glasses. Now we're currently stepping into the direction of going 5G with this. So actually full coverage would be of great help for us. And then last but not least, we detect what's happening on the river by artificially enhanced image recognition. We can, without human intervention, already detect, label, and quantify several items passing by. So needless to say that this is technology that we can see applicable in all our operations and all our fleet. That's all I wanted to say for now. Thank you for listening.
Oh, sorry. Thank you, Wouter. You highlighted the projects and also the concerns of the water building industry. And now it is my pleasure to introduce you to Catherine Scheers. Catherine is the owner and operator of a fleet of short sea going vessels. Catherine, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Wouter, and thank you, Wilfried. Thanks for the invitation to speak. Welcome to Virtual Antwerp. I'm Catherine Scheers, owner of FAST Group, Fast offers total logistics solutions. Therefore, we invest in break bulk short sea ships. These ships sail to different ports around Europe. With Fast Coasters, we offer three kinds of services. First, we ship contracts for clients. Second, we transship break bulk cargoes from bigger ports to all corners of Europe. And third, Fast organizes regular break bulk liner services. On the slide, you see an example of this. Fast Sam, a vessel named after my youngest son, arriving from Port of Antwerp to Fast terminals in Drogheda. Fast ships fly Belgian flag. They have a crew of six, which rotate every 10 weeks. And I'm proud to say that even during COVID, we kept doing crew changes, although this was challenging. Another big challenge is complying with rest and work hours in such small teams. And as Wouter stated, finding crews becomes more and more difficult too. Autonomous ships can be an answer to that. Let us bring the best in class together and start testing autonomous shipping with small short sea ships over short fixed distances. In that way, we gather experience and can scale it up. Like Louis Robert Cole explained, let's start with limiting the crew to, in the end, having no crew at all. The aim of autonomous shipping is to improve quality of life for people and planet. I'll explain this planet. If ships are small and have frequent sailings, they can take more freight from our congested roads, picking up cargoes deep into the hinterland and delivering it almost at the customer's doorstep. People, if captains and crew work ashore, the job would be easier to combine with family life, thus attracting a bigger pool of both male and female seafarers. As Minister van Quickenborne, Koen Gernaert and others stated, to enable autonomous shipping, international regulations, common protocols, standards and ports need to follow. But instead of focusing on all the challenges, Belgian ship owners have a can-do mentality and are prepared to start testing, adapting step by step, and fine-tune along the way. I now pass the word to Wilfried, and I think Wilfried agrees that we Belgian ship owners go boldly beyond to shape a better future for all. Thank you.
Thank you, Catherine. And indeed, I completely or fully share your boldly beyond vision, where we highlight and also important the work at sea for our seafarers. Can I have my presentation now, please? Thank you. So when I started my seagoing career a while ago, not that long ago, as a captain, I received my voyage order, and it was a load 60,000 tons somewhere on the Mississippi River, 10% MOLO, more or less owner's option, discharging port somewhere Korea. And then as a captain, I was on my own. Were there any challenges during the voyage? I had to find a solution myself. Now, together or thanks to modern technology, whenever there is a problem, a captain can phone contact his office. And there the challenge, the problem is solved together as a in team spirit. This incorporation will continue in the next coming years. So what we see is that in less of one team operation on board the ship, it will be a complete team operation based on the shore. The captain and the crew will be part of a team together with the technical superintendent, together with the commercial manager, that will operate the ship in a team spirit, in a broader view. This incorporation will continue. We cannot stop it anymore. And of course, there is another aspect that will speed up this, this evolution, or shall I say revolution, is the COVID-19. We all know the difficulties that we had to embark the crews. It will make think many seafarers worldwide about their future. And they will start thinking about if they see the commercial introductions made by, amongst others, Rolls-Royce or Kongsberg, about how they are going to operate the vessels. You see the captain sitting in a control room based ashore, and then he will be remotely controlling the vessel. Now, I hear from several corners, maybe it will take away opportunities of a seagoing career. I do not think so, because in the first time, a seagoing vessel will be remotely controlled on the ocean. Once the seagoing vessel is entering a harbor, a marine crew will go on board, will dock the vessel, make it fast, start loading, discharging in case of a tanker, washing, inerting the tanks, etc. And then will again sail this vessel towards the seaboy, towards the entry of the ocean, and there the vessel will be remotely controlled. So as a matter of fact, the seafarer's job will, first of all, ocean going shift to the shore controlled control room. And secondly, once approaching a port, there will be a local crew going on board and operating the vessel together, of course, with the shore-based team. So that, in short, is our vision about how we are going to remote control our vessels in the future. Sophie, the floor is back yours.
Thank you, Wilfried, for this session. And thank you also for all the previous speakers for their fascinating and thought-provoking presentations. We've now arrived at the next port of today's voyage, our Q&A session, which will be moderated by Mark from the Blue Cluster.
So here I am again, and also thank you again to my colleagues from the Royal Belgian Shipowners Association, who, as some of you might know, have a very special place in my heart. When I was looking at the Q&A and the questions asked, I think that one of the first things that popped up, and we'll go through the polls a little bit later, but is the question about cybersecurity. And I would like to ask Mitch if he could just enlighten us a little bit more again on, because some people argue that it's very easy, as has been proven in a test a few years ago, to take remote control of a yacht or a large vessel, because these chips are not currently not that well protected. But maybe Mitch can just tell us a little bit what role, for instance, the mobile private networks can play in this.
Yes, thank you, Mark. Well, of course, that's true for all industries all over the world, not only for autonomous shipping, but cybersecurity and the further digitalization of our society. It's very important that all stakeholders into the telecommunication and IT business come together to make sure that the systems we set up are secure. I think that's logic. You can't stop the revolution or the evolution towards digitalization. And I think it's up to all of us, and also the legislators, to make sure there is a framework in place and the systems are in place to ensure the security of all those systems. But I can assure you that we as a company and the industry as a whole are working hard together with also a lot of funding from the European Union to ensure the security of all the systems that that we deploy.
Thank you, Mitch. That was a clear answer. And before we go to the questions of the polls, is Steven Luss, who is very much involved into everything that is dealing with defense, of course, cybersecurity for a defense industry, is of top-notch priority. So, Steven, if you could just in a few words give us your thoughts on cybersecurity, because I know you have a lot of expertise in that field.
Well, as you indicate yourself, without cybersecurity, the system that I described cannot be deployed. It's clear that it is totally unacceptable that a foreign power or another malicious power would be able to take over a military system. And therefore, it is of utmost requirement that all of the radio links, all of the the algorithms that are involved with our autonomous drone system for demining are actually completely protected. And of course, this is an easy statement to make here, but there is a lot at stake, there is a lot involved. And so our development teams who are developing the system, both from a mothership as well as from the autonomous vessels point of view, including the radio links that are there to give instructions and receive data back from the drones, radio links via line of sight radio, but also via connection over satellites. It's of utmost importance that all of these links are being protected. So it's not only about physical access that malicious people might want to have onto drones which are unable to protect themselves, because by definition, an autonomous drone, it can almost not protect itself from intrusion, physical intrusion. Also, intrusion via radio frequency is to be foreseen. So we're working on both aspects, and we had to guarantee that towards the Belgian and Dutch Navy before we could only start on this project. I hope this answers the question from the military, I would say.
Yeah, absolutely, Stephen. To me, it was very clear. And we also know that there are a lot of spillover effects from anything that comes from defense industry to other sectors. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we have little time left, of course, and we're strict on time, which is very good. I would like to congratulate the speakers for that. Let's just have a quick look at the polls, and I have two questions for two candidates still. So the first question was, to what extent do you believe that deep ocean shipping will be autonomous by 2050? And of course, the majority of the questions was that people think it's going to be semi-autonomous or remote control. I think indeed, if ever ships will sail fully autonomously, that it is not going to be in the next 30 years. But ladies and gentlemen, I would like to stress you, and we see that every day when you work in an innovation cluster, there's going to be still need for a lot of innovation before we can move on to the next stages. Now, question number two in the poll was, what are the largest impediments you see? And the majority of the people, of course, tacked the lack of regulatory framework. And then it's nice to see that Belgium is on the forefront of taking actions, and we have a regulatory framework in place for autonomous ships. It puts us again at the forefront of maritime nations who are involved. But of course, cybersecurity, as we just saw, and safety are main concerns. But the last question is one where I will try to solicit some reply from one of the speakers. Is, in your opinion, what are the greatest drivers for autonomous shipping? And people go to safety and lower OPEX, things that were covered by Louis from CIFAR. But I would like to ask a question to Louis about this. He answered the question on the crew work-life balance and on safety and on lower OPEX, but he also mentioned emission reduction. And apparently that is not very clear for people. So Louis, if you could just tell us a little bit about how do you see that autonomous shipping contributes to lower emissions?
Thank you, Mark. Yes, indeed, a very good question. If we look at our industry, we see in the inland shipping industry that the average age of a vessel is quite old. It's 40 years. So we are in the front of a new generation of vessels. And if we want to reach zero emission shipping, we need to start building new vessels. But this is very difficult for small vessel owners or shipping companies in the inland shipping industry because the initial investment in building new vessels is quite high. So it's a CapEx story. If we can change that by introducing autonomous shipping, making sure that on the CapEx side, so building the vessel with larger cargo capacity, limiting the investments in let's say, accommodation for skippers, the room, use the room for skippers for as cargo holds, etc., then we can start changing the business case by lowering the capex. And secondly, if we can start enhancing or increasing the OPEX efficiency by, I give you an example, we run a container vessel between Antwerp and Leuk. There, when there are waiting times for a vessel to start loading or unloading in the port of Antwerp, it's possible for us to switch off the shore control center, let the limited onboard crew follow up on the vessel and do maintenance. And if we need to navigate with the vessel, start navigating on demand, meaning that we make the cost of crew variable instead of fixed. It's one example. Another example is navigating with a vessel from a shore control center, really looking at the analytics of the vessel in the shore control center to save on fuel, etc. So CAPEX and OPEX, those two result in the fact that you can optimize the business case. When you have more room to invest in a new vessel, a vessel owner will quickly realize that it's interesting to start investing in green propulsion and green systems on board as well, because it's payable. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Louis. And we're still keeping schedule. And I have, of course, one last question for, of course, Wilfried Lemmes from the Royal Belgian Shipowners Association. Wilfried, the Shipowners Association will launch a think tank on autonomous shippings, on autonomous shipping. So it would be very, very nice for us to hear how do you see this? When is this going to happen? But I will ask you to be extremely brief because we're at the end of the Q&A.
Well, thank you for the question, Mark. Referring to the Maritime Industry Decarbonization Council think tank, we will start in September this year a think tank where we will invite all maritime stakeholders concerning to remote controlled vessels. We will look at all aspects, whether it is legal, operational, technical, and any other subjects. So the floor is back to you.
Of course, we will all look very much forward, Wilfried, for participating in the think tank, and thank you very much for setting this up. And that means, ladies and gentlemen, that my job is done for this webinar, and I give the word back to Sophie.
Thank you very much, and a job well done, I would say. Thanks also to all of our speakers and all of our participants to make this an interactive and interesting Q&A session. As we announced, we're making the commitment to answer the remaining questions in writing, and you will find this these answers, the questions and the answers, on the web site, and the recording will be there as well. So the questions that were answered here today, you will still be able to listen to those answers that were given out loud in this webinar. Please allow me to introduce Mr. Jean-Baptiste Merveille. Jean-Baptiste is a policy advisor at the DG for Shipping, Federal Public Service of Mobility and Transport, where he focuses on navigation and radio communication issues. And he will be the one who will bring us summary conclusions on the presentations and discussions of this webinar. Jean-Baptiste.
Yes, sorry, thank you. Thank you, Sophie, for giving me the floor. As we are slowly already reaching the end of our webinar, it's always great to see the interest in autonomous navigation among colleagues from other countries, and of course among the Belgian partners. It was particularly interesting to follow the discussions during this webinar. And I would like to take this opportunity to already sincerely thank all the participants on behalf of the Federal Public Service Mobility and Transport. This webinar clearly demonstrates that we have entered a new period of for autonomous navigation. Now the hype is giving way to a more realistic and pragmatic approach, which is, I think, a positive positive thing for the realization of the concept. And in the same way, it will certainly help to develop further the regulation that is not built off the ground, but rather based on concrete and feasible ideas. Now, I won't keep the floor too long, and I would like to quickly go over a few points that I know during this webinar. So many challenges were identified in parallel during this webinar. We talked about maintenance, technology, communication, network, cybersecurity. All these elements will inevitably have to be addressed properly and in the most integrated possible way. It seems important to us to avoid diluting the mass concepts in an excessively complex approach that would end up in making it cumbersome to handle. And also from a practical point of view, focusing on an integrated and holistic approach will also allow for a more methodical development of the regulation. And this is certainly a major point at international level, given the already heavy agendas of the IMO committees. I mean, they cannot afford to be overwhelmed by requests for overly specific outputs. Now, with regards more specifically with a mass pilot project, as we saw some very interesting examples throughout the webinar, when a mass operation is being performed, at the end of the day, we are dealing with a navigational mode. This is a functional approach that we can follow in the future in order to embrace the concept of autonomy as a whole and include all the mass projects that can cover a very wide range of variety, from a small hydrographic autonomous USV, as on the Vlis, or a 3,000 gross tonnage container ship operated remotely. So indeed, from a functional perspective, there are no small projects, and every application brings additional and valuable input to the development of autonomous shipping. Further, the mass testing is also inevitably linked to risk assessment. And risk assessment is important because it demonstrates that there is, in principle, no opposition between technology development in one hand and safety, security, environmental protection requirements on the other hand, at least when this risk assessment is properly done. And that is why, as a maritime administration, we put the emphasis on assessing the risk assessment. This assessment should be done then by the applicant. Now, without transition, let me jump to another major point for autonomous navigation that was also raised by several participants, like the Royal Belgian Ship Owners Association. Well, that may seem counterintuitive, but the human element is in fact an integral part of MASS. Whether we are talking about training of seafarers on board a ship or in shore control centers in the CIFAR, but also management of mixed traffic situation as raised among others by Kuhn from DotOcean and also by Mark Neutemans, or even the inclusion of experience and know-how from seafarers. This is the human element is central for the MASS development. And I would like to make a quick parallel here with the EGDIS, which was expected by some to replace the second mate decades ago. In the end, of course, we still have nowadays navigation officer, but what we have witnessed is actually a shift of skills. So I will not start now a completely new presentation, of course. I would like to conclude my intervention by saying that regulatory initiatives exist now. And Belgium wants to do its share to motivate applicants to conduct trials and projects at sea in Belgium. However, it is important not to neglect the international efforts and to note that when it comes to maritime regulation, a patchwork of local or regional regulations will never be as effective as an integrated international regulation. And this is also actually a kind of holistic approach. And now that the scoping exercise of the Maritime Safety Committee is finalized, the focus should be on identifying pathways for the future work and requesting for a new output with a result that comes into force as soon as possible, but while remaining within the IMO process, of course. And why not being very optimistic here? It was a dynamic webinar. We can think already of 2028 with maybe a new dedicated instrument. Why not? Anyway, I believe that 2021, this year, can be considered already in Belgium as a pivotal year between a preparatory work and the start of a real implementation of autonomous navigation. And I would like to insist again, as we saw all along this webinar, that we are fortunate here in Belgium to be able to count on a great deal of dynamism in the maritime sector, without which we would not be able to move in the right direction. Thank you all, If there is any questions or remark or thoughts, please not hesitate to send an email to the address which is shown now on the screen. And you may use the same address, of course, in order to submit an application for mass trials at sea in Belgium. I give back the floor to you, Sophie, and thank you again.
Thank you, Jean-Baptiste. This brings us to the end of this webinar. I would like to thank the speakers and the participants. I hope you found this short webinar interesting and helpful for further discussions on the development, including within the IMO, of a legal and operational framework and a level playing field in support of the development of autonomous shipping. As a blue leader, Belgium will use its ocean diplomacy and work in multilateral fora to advance these discussions on autonomous shipping. Please check the website for the presentations and the recording of this webinar. You'll get an email alert in any case. And all that remains for me is to wish you a wonderful day and thank you for being with us today.